Do you ever get grim? Do you ever feel that you have to run the whole universe by yourself? Do you ever feel that you're the only one who's responsible? Well, we all feel that way at times. And the antidote to grimness is grace. And the inner experience of grace bursts forth in joy. Jesus came that we might have joy. And it's for you, and it's for right now. Our scripture lesson today is a gift of joy. It's Jesus' explanation of how we can find joy as a consistent and constant experience in our life. Take your Bible, if you will. Turn to the 15th chapter of John. We're going to read the first 11 verses. And I want you to note the 11th verse in particular, because the whole passage moves toward that and climax in that marvelous promise given to us by Jesus the I Am. Hear now the word of God. Jesus said, I am the vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch of mine that bears no fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it may bear more fruit. You are already made clean by the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If a man does not abide in me, he is cast forth as a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you will and it will be done to you. By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. Let us pray. Gracious God, I pray that you will move among us now, touching each one of us, that we may receive your special gift of grace, and that it may be manifested in the fruit of joy on our faces, in our words, in all that we say and do and are. Through Jesus Christ, joy himself, we humbly pray. Amen. I have a super friend who, each time we finish a visit, takes a hold of my hand, shakes it, looks me squarely in the eye, and leaves me with this parting shot. Whatever you do, don't miss the joy. I like that. I told a conference about that, where I was a speaker, and it became the motto of the conference. People greeted each other along the path of the conference grounds saying, good morning. Whatever you do today, don't miss the joy. Or they'd say good night to each other and say, see you tomorrow. Don't miss the joy. And it actually became a motto that was spoken all over the conference. It became the theme of everything that we said and did. Don't miss the joy. It's my deepest prayer for you right now that whatever you do, whatever happens to you, around you, through you, to the people you love, to the time of history of which you are a part, whatever you do, don't miss the joy. But an honest appraisal of life is that many of us are missing the joy. Look at the faces of people along any street. Look at people gathered together at any party with all of the happy greetings that lack in joy. Talk to your friends and your loved ones, and the thing that you long more than anything else is that somehow they'll experience the true meaning of joy. The opposite of joy is grimness. And there is a kind of grimness that is registered upon our faces. Grimness is taking yourselves too seriously and not taking Jesus Christ and his promises seriously enough. There are some of us who are grim when we feel we have to do everything by ourselves. We hang on with white-knuckled tenacity, saying, I'm the only one who cares. I'm the only one who's responsible. Everyone else is fooling around, and I'm holding things together. And we get kind of grim. It's like a man who wanted to share the Christian faith, and he'd get out on a street corner. You've heard about people who buttonhole others and say, are you saved? Well, this fellow was a little more refined than that. And with a grimace kind of face, as people went by him, he'd say, have you got the joy? Well, if that was joy that he had, I didn't want any part of it. But there are some of us who feel that we must run the universe and everyone around us and keep everything intact, every place a thing and everything a place and every person a slot. We get grim, don't we, when that happens? Still others of us are grim because we feel we have no right to joy. We know the things that we've said and done, the words that we've spoken that we wish we never had said, the things that we've done that we wish we'd never had done. And we say to ourselves, you have no right to joy. Being the kind of person you've been, you have no right to radiate joy. You ever get that grim? Then there's still others of us who are so intent on straightening out people's thinking that we never allow them just to enjoy the wonder of Jesus Christ. We straighten out their theology, be sure that they've exposited every passage correctly. We press them into the right creeds, get them into the ecclesiastical organization, and tell them to work their fingers to the bone in church committees. And keep the joy. William Barclay was right. He said, it's a contradiction of terms when you see a joyless Christian. He said, nothing has hurt the advancement of Christianity any more than its association with black clothing and long-faced church members. I'm sure you've heard the wonderful story of the young pastor in Scotland. Some visitors came through the village and they said, are you the dominie? And he said, oh no, I've got a stomach ache. We don't always identify the lack of joy with religious people, but I know a lot of juiceless, joyless religious people. And Jesus Christ came that we might experience joy. In one of his most triumphant I am statements, he gave us the secret, the source, and the sustenance of joy. The passage that we read gives us the progression in a marvelous way. Jesus tells us, I am the vine. Then he tells us that we are the branches, that he's the source of the sustenance, and that the result of having received his strength is the fruit of joy. Jesus had just finished serving the Last Supper. He broke the bread, symbolic of his body which was about to be broken. He served the cup and reminded them that his blood would be shed for their forgiveness as a once never to be repeated substitutionary sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. And then they left the upper room there in Jerusalem, walked through the dark streets, and then through the precincts of the temple, and then on across the Kidron Valley to Gethsemane, where Jesus was to pray his deep prayer of surrender and entrust his death and his resurrection to God Almighty. We can imagine them carrying their torches as they went along, the light casting a shadow on one of the most dynamic symbols of ancient Israel. Around the door of the temple was the beautifully carved, gold leaf-filled imagery of the vine and the branches and the fruit of the vine in the grapes. It was based on one of the firm, dynamic convictions of ancient Israel. For example, in the 80th Psalm, the 8th and 9th verse, the psalmist said, O Lord, thou hast taken a fair vine out of Egypt. Thou hast cleared away the nations and planted the vine in a fair land. Isaiah picked that up in the 5th chapter, leading up to the 7th verse. There he declared that Israel was the vine of God in the vineyard of the promised land. Ezekiel carries on the same imagery with a note of judgment that the people of God had not been faithful to God as the vine. And that was the reason that outside of the temple was this imagery of the vine. And as they walked by, Jesus pointed up to it and then turned back to his disciples, stopped them as they were following him and said, I am the vine. Ego eimi. The vine. And thus he said, it isn't by Hebrew blood alone. It's with a love relationship with me that you know the power of God. I am the source of your life, the source of your joy. Now note what he said, helping us to understand how the Spirit of God moves into our life and gives us joy. He is the vine, and we are the branches, and the fruit of the branch is the joy. The sap of love in the power of the Spirit moves from the vine into the branch, and thus flowers and eventually knows the fruitation in the giving of the grape. Jesus is suggesting that only as we are attached to him can we feel the surge of the ecstasy of joy. It is an outer manifestation of the inner experience of his love. It's interesting that in Greek, the same root is used in grace and in joy, charis and chara. Joy is the outer expression of the deep inner experience of an abiding sense of God's grace. Grace is unmerited, unchanging, unmotivated, unearned love. What that means right now is this, that God knows us and loves us and forgives us, goes before us, watches over us, lives his life in us, cares for the details of our life, arranges things according to his plan, wastes nothing, helps us in everything, and out of that experience of grace, love for us though we do not deserve it, joy springs forth with an artesian flow. We cannot contain it. But move on to the secret of the experience of joy. Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. But he also said, every branch that bears fruit, the Father will prune. And every branch that bears no fruit, he will cut away. And it will wither. And it will be burned in the fire. There's the secret of joy. We're right at the core of it now. Those whom the Lord loves, he prunes back that they might be able to produce greater fruit. All you need to do is to go to the Holy Land in the spring, and you can see what Jesus meant. Go into a vineyard, a series of stubby, grotesque, homely, bleeding little vines, stems, unattractive in every way. But come back in the fall. Walk in the vineyard, the fair vineyard of the Lord. And as a result of the pruning, has begun to grow the beautiful, strong branches on which are the fruit of the pruning. The only way to know true joy is to experience the presence and power of God in those things which other people would call a distraction of happiness. The pruning process is the perspective of God on our difficulties. What happens to us and around us can either be that which makes us hard and negative and hostile, or with the perspective of God, we can discover what he's doing in our lives and trust him with it and experience his love in the midst of our loss and our hurt, our frustration, our anxiety, the things that break us and hurt us. If we have his perspective on it, it's out of that pruning, that the branch grows strong and the sap of his love moves from the vine into our very souls. And in those things that would break anyone else, we can sing and laugh and rejoice. That's the whole meaning behind that marvelous verse in the 29th chapter of 1 Chronicles. Remember it? Hezekiah has taken over the leadership of Israel. An evil king has been deposed. The temple is cleansed. And Hezekiah calls the people of God to come and make a sacrifice. Asks them to think of themselves as placed upon the high altar. When the he-goat, as representative of the sin offering, is placed there. Hezekiah has the Levites come with the harps and the cymbals and the trumpets. And they stand around and wait while the people gather around the altar. The he-goat is placed on the altar. It is drenched with the pitch that will light it. And then the priest comes with his burning torch down among the people, through the people, and up to the high altar, and he lights the sacrifice. And then is that marvelous verse in Chronicles that says, and then they made the sacrifice to the Lord. And then also began the song of the Lord with trumpets. That's what it means to be pruned back. Paul said, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. When you place your life, your total life, and those things that happen to you that could distress and hurt you, place them upon the altar. They become the sacrifice. But with the sacrifice comes the song and the trumpet. And when the trumpet comes, there's joy that cannot be taken away. The other day I heard the story of a pastor in Texas who, when through the tragic loss of his daughter by the name of Joy, prior to her death, he had written a sermon, and he gave it that Sunday, regardless of his broken heart. And the title that he had printed and had published in the paper was, "Have you lost your joy? What do you do? Has life broken you? Or has the broken things of life made you the kind of person you were meant to be?" There's a great difference when you see the face of a person who's gone through life as it really is. There's a tenderness in the eye, a softness in the face, a warmth in the voice, an inclusiveness in the arms, a vulnerability in the midst of life. And joy, the sacrifice, and the trumpet. And the closer we come to Jesus, and as we abide in Him and He in us, joy becomes the artesian quality of our life that is absolutely undiminishable. Do you know that? It's my prayer for you. My friend's benedictory blessing is not so bad, is it? It's my deepest yearning hope for you. Whatever you do, wherever you are, whatever happens to you or around you, don't miss the joy.